give you all the honor. And oh God, we thank you for Mary Mitchell right now, Lord Jesus. We thank you for the staff members. We thank you for the director, Heidi. Oh God, we know you're able to do all things. Whatever we are here to do today, my God, let it be for real. And oh God, we praise you right now, Lord Jesus. These are our blessings. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Good afternoon, everybody. Hi, my name is Darren Washington. I'm a board member of the Mary Mitchell Center and a long resident. Are y'all happy to be here?
Yes.
Yes, so this is the beginning of a new Crotona Community Coalition. The old Crotona Community Coalition, gosh, was founded maybe over 30 years ago in this neighborhood as part of revitalization around housing. I remember when we first moved in, this neighborhood had so many empty lots, and many of the residents were trying to meet with landlords because they had no heating or water, schools were in disarray, and so it was the Crotona Community Coalition that gathered the community together to show their strength to change this community with people power. And through Austin Jacobo, who was the president and founder of the Crotona Community Coalition, his legacy lives on today. And so I just want to get a shout out because I know many of you are here from different organizations. I can't name them all, but there'll be time for networking. So if you're from a religious organization, can you give a little shout out? Woo! Yes, everyone should be like, count out the churches, synagogues. Okay, what about schools? Okay, anyone from schools?
Yeah.
All right, how about elected officials? How about the parks department?
Yeah.
How about the private sector? How about community residents?
Yeah.
How about friends of Mary Mitchell and Crotona? So today is going to be a gathering of ideas and to sort of move this community in a new direction. You know, when we look at our community, we should look at, forget about what you hear about the deficits. We have strength here. Look at the power that is invested, especially amongst our youth. Look at the power that is invested in our seniors. Look at the power as the community. The seed over here is a representation of what this vast, beautiful community will look like in the future. So, without further ado, I hope Heidi, that's my 2 minutes. Oh, one more thing I just want to sort of say is that the Crotona Community Coalition was part of the Northwest Bronx Community Clergy Coalition. I want to give a shout out to them because the organization was the umbrella of that. So, Israel, without further ado, Heidi, give me my 2 minutes.
Perfect.
Good afternoon. Hi. I've been a member for 8 years. 1972. 1978, we would play ball on the street, but we had a way to play. The child was 15 years old. The super from the building that we have now, the only building standing at the park, said, let's clean up this area here so we can play ball, and you have to be out of the street. We can put the kid, we clean the hard area, and we started to play ball there. Get some real quick, so he said, we need a fence. We went to the market. We asked him to think if any possible way that we could make this into an official park. He went, that time he said he was going to talk to the mayor, see what happens. And the mayor did flew in the helicopter, landed at the park. That's how he used to travel, by the way, helicopter. So since that day, we devoted the park there. And so far, it's been like 40 years, it is a face-up. It is a new reality to build it, everything that was there. So that's what it's doing.
Hi everybody, I'm Heidi. I'm the director of the Mary Mitchell Family and Youth Center. And Israel worked on that baseball field 30 years ago, and Israel's son, who is now 16, is helping us with this visioning process, as are all the young people at the center. So I just want to give you a little history of how we got to today. So thanks to Congressman Serrano, the Mary Mitchell Center had enough money to buy the building that's in the baseball field, and we did that 10 years ago. We had a lot of different ideas. do. We originally wanted to tear it down, but everything was just too expensive. So where we're at right now is we decided we're going to reuse it, right? We're going to use it for neighborhood programs, and we want not only the building, but the whole field to be developed. And the Mary Mitchell Center has a board that are all from the neighborhood, and all of our staff are from the neighborhood, and we have a fantastic teen council of young people in our neighborhood. And the first thing we did was we went through a visioning process with all of us, right? And if you look on the back wall and around, we thought we got together with a group called Designing the We, who took us through 8 weeks every Friday of thinking about what would serve us best. What is the history of our neighborhood? What are the forces we've been up against? And how can we really transform our neighborhood by just transforming one building and one park? And we believe that we can. We can totally make this neighborhood better for those of us who live here through that one bit of work. But we know that it's just not our good ideas. We came up with great ideas, and you're going to hear about some of those. And then we created a neighborhood survey to ask people in the neighborhood, just people that were around during a ball game, but also there are 25 groups, churches, other religious organizations, schools, the senior center, other nonprofits, and we went to all 25 and asked for their members to fill out the survey so we could get a sense of what, of all the ideas we have, what are the ones people care about the most. And some of the results of our, we got over 400 surveys filled out, and some of the results are along the back wall. At the end of the meeting, you can take a look. But of all the results, we're able to fit a lot of what we feel we need into the ball field and the building. So today, not only are we going to show you what has happened so far in our thinking, but if you have not gotten a chance to fill out a survey, or if you think of something when you see this presentation that you think would benefit the project, we want you at the end to fill out the survey, and also we're going to have some post-its so that people can add ideas that they come up with. And this is particularly important for the young people in the room, because when you hear what we're trying to do, you may think of something that you haven't heard us say, and we want to hear what you're thinking. That's super important to us. So that's my 2 minutes, or maybe 2.5. So now what we're going to do is we're going to hear from the architects that we have, who have drawn pictures. They've taken all of our ideas, and they have drawn pictures. And Greg goes from Designing the We, who helped us through our process, is also going to sort of help us to show the, help us to show the pictures that we have so far. And we're really hoping that as you're thinking about this, you can add your voice. Is there something that you don't see there that you want? Let's hear about it, right? So we're gonna get that information at the end of the meeting, okay. Oh yeah, and why don't Arnold and Zakiya, oh not Arnold yet, just Zakiya, sorry, just Zakiya.
All right, Zakiya, speak.
Hi everybody, good afternoon. My name is Gregory, I'm with Designing the We, and this is Zakiya, Mary Mitchell Center, and we're gonna just share really briefly with you guys about the process.
We want a patio around the building and around the legates too. My concern is for the elected officials that we are expecting you as communities to help us to improve that field. So the children, so those are some of the things that I'm interested in, and we are interested in. If you help us improve that park, then our kids, the kids are very energetic. They want some outlet.
Yeah.
In the schools, we have shared space. So if we, let's suppose we had to give 4 days of gym, we can only do 2. Reason why? Shared space. So that package is a very, very good asset to our kids. We would appreciate if you find some money somewhere.
Yeah.
It's then we just need to put it where it is, set the budget, and Help our kids, please. Community needs you. You need our community. Thank you.
We have talked to the Parks Department about this project, and we've talked to most of our elected officials in general about the project. The rehabilitation of the building will cost around $3.5 million. And the rehabilitation of the park, wait for it, cost $8 million. So it's not going to be, nobody in this room is going to write a check today to make this happen. But we live, as always, in faith that when the right thing, when we know what the right thing is to do, we will ultimately be able to do it.
Amen.
In order to be where we are, though, we couldn't even own that building if it wasn't for Congressman Serrano, who and we know that the Congressman has always supported the center. The whole 20 years were open. So we have no doubt that he will, and his fabulous staff, will figure out ways to help us make this dream, this Astinapolo dream, a reality. So we would really like the Congressman to come up, and we want to give you a presentation, and then you can tell us what you're thinking. So come on up, and I have it. These young scholars are part of our after-school program, and we have a picture on the plaque of all of a group of them when they were at Central Park and they were blowing a really big bubble. So you'll have to come and see it, and then just in gratitude to Congressman Serrano for all of his support. So you guys, you want to hand that over to Congressman?
Thank you so much. Coming to Mary Mitchell has been home. It's been a long, 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 long association. And I'm always surprised, wherever I go these days, for people to recognize our work. And I say our work because all I do is represent your thoughts in Washington. It's been a while. We've been doing this for a while now, and I feel good about it. I see people here who are adults and whose graduation I went to when they were in the fifth grade or something. I always, and Richie Torres is without a doubt one of the brightest young stars in New York State politics, and I believe that he will go all the way. And when you do, Richie, when you go all the way, just remember who opened the door. So, you know, I'm so blessed. I just won, and please understand, because Mary Mitchell has a very strong faith foundation, which is a fact, not just a community center, it's founded on faith in each other and on faith in our Creator. So sometimes it may seem to you like I'm boasting or bragging. I just want to give you a little history. I'm now beginning my 43rd year as an elected official.
Wow.
Longer than anyone in the history of the Bronx. Longer than Bruckner, and he's got a highway named after him. I'm always telling Mitchie, there's got to be at least an alleyway. Cayejón Serrano. There's a jamón in Spain, but you know. And secondly, I'm the longest serving elected official of Puerto Rican background anywhere in the United States. Longer than anybody in the history of Puerto Rico. Which is interesting because I did it all over here. But anyway, why am I saying that? He's bragging. No. to say thank you to you, and to say to the younger people, if you stick with a dream, that we will never leave you. And when you consider the baseball players, when they reach a certain point, don't have it anymore, singers lose their voice, I'm lucky. I just got 95% of the vote, which is the highest in the nation. I'm very excited about this. I was excited when it was presented, and I see possibilities beyond perhaps the ones that have been spoken about. For instance, that recording studio. I know what the recording studio will do with music and our culture. But you know something? Richie and I, when we have a tough election, we have to spend a lot of money on radio commercials, on TV commercials that go on cablevision. They go, why can't you train a group of people to do everything from writing my script, to putting the makeup on, to recording me, to making sure it gets on TV, all as a package that we pay for. We do that with other people. Why can't it be done here? And an idea. Once other candidates know during an election time that there is a recording studio with young people that can do this in the Bronx, they'll want to, for if nothing else, political reasons, be able to say my commercial was done by young people in the Bronx. So don't think it's a totally crazy idea. There's a possibility that in there, and I put it and plant it in your heads for those who know how to do this. It's not just, really not just, there's nothing greater in the world of music. It's not just music, it's also the possibility of another thing. How many commercials do you hear on TV for Sibalbis? Sibalbis are the people who make American salami, right? Why do they always have to go to New Jersey to get those commercials recorded? Why do they have to go to 52nd Street to get those commercials recorded? So, you know, the possibilities are endless. And of course, the baseball field, which we will all try to revive and fix, has other possibilities too. For instance, why can't a local team, the community picks the better team, the professionals pick a better team, play a visiting team from Puerto Rico, a visiting team from the DR, the Dominican Republic, a visiting team from Cuba. You know, why, in other words, we have to think beyond what we thought about in the past. We have to think big. We dream big dreams. Someone told me in high school, I'll never forget this, told me, Joe, reach for the moon. And if you don't reach it on your way down, you'll get a handful of stars. And that's what my life has been like. So this is very exciting. I'm committed to it. I have to apologize to you because both Richie and I have to move on to other events. That's what we do on the Saturday that we're here. But I'm with you. You don't have to, you know, worry about me. You have to worry about the guy who's going to be president. That's why, when you said you were building a fence, I got very nervous. But I realized it was not that fence. So we'll see, we'll continue to work. Thank you for treating me with such respect and such love. And I appreciate, you know, the relationship we have. I will continue to do my work. I'm ready for this new government. I'm ready to take them on. And you know, just when I think I've done it all in politics, they bring somebody home like that who now has to bring me back to protecting voting rights, and women's rights, and minority rights, and that's what I'm going to go for. So we're going to appeal to his New York part of him, if not, then we'll give him a hard time. But thank you so much, and God bless you all.
We would like to thank our company Victorious for funding our entire group. We would like to thank them with the book, which is really, yeah, it took months to make. It's about like our experiences and everything we were able to accomplish because of this document. And everything that's in that book is the reason why we keep on coming back, keep on giving that book.
but I'm the youngest elected official. And first, I'm proud to be as supportive of the Mary Mitchell Center. I think over the course of 3 years, we've allocated about $100,000, you know the exact math. I've asked if you could raise the eligibility for your youth programming so that I could benefit. Would you turn me down? All the funding for affordable housing development in New York City is federal. And so if the Republican is in Congress and the president do away with those programs, the mayor's housing plan collapses. Right? There's a sense in which Donald Trump has more control of the fate of the mayor's housing plan than the mayor himself. And that's just one example. Whether it's parks, whether it's social services, whether it's housing. So we should keep dreaming, but we should also be honest about the realities that we face. But we have no choice but to keep fighting, because our resources, our community simply does not get the resources that it deserves. Second, as a council member, I have member rights. So I have a pot of $5 million, which sounds like a lot of money. But I represent a district that covers the North Bronx, the South Bronx, and the East Bronx, and the West Bronx. I have the Parks Commissioner can tell you I have one of the largest amounts of parks in. And one park can cost more than all the money I received from my whole district. And not only do I have to invest in parks improvements, but there's affordable housing, there's public safety, there's need for safer streets, there's public housing, there are schools and libraries. So those are the realities that we face. Having said that, we should keep fighting, keep exerting pressure on your elected officials. And I'm going to need you to help me exert pressure on the mayor's office where the money is. See, it's not only enough to have a vision for improving your community, you need a strategy for pressuring those in power. And so I encourage you to agitate. Now, I'm here to tell you that I'm committed to beginning an investment in Mace Ballfield. I just want to be clear, I heard, I think the dollar amount I heard was $8 million.
Just for the park.
Just for the park. So I think in this fiscal year, I'm committed, I think I'm going to reallocate $200,000. Woo! And then I will work with each and every one of you to bring as many resources as I can so that we can slowly but surely get to what I hope is that it would, see, one of the frustrations I have with parks, you know, I love the commissioner, is I'll say, how much is that park? It's 2.5 million. Okay, so I get the 2.5 million. Well, council member, it's not 5 million. That's the challenge we face, is that one park can have more in capital needs than I have in funding for the whole district. But I'm committed to working with each of you, but I'm also going to need all of you to help me pressure the mayor's office. Because the community that has been the most shortchanged, and the commissioner will tell you this, under the Parks Equity Initiative is ours. Is that there have been huge investments in other neighborhoods of the Bronx, in other boroughs, and our community has not received its fair share. And so we're going to have to fight for our fair share. And so I need you to be partners with me in agitating for more resources for our community. But I'm here to partner with you, I need you to partner with me. Participatory budgeting. So I have an initiative known as participatory budgeting. It's a process by which local residents can vote and have a voice in how $1 million is spent in their own district. So it's deliberative democracy at the local level. It's a year-long process of developing ideas for how to improve your community. We work with government agencies like parks to translate those ideas into actual proposals. And then we vote over the course of a week. And those proposals that get the most votes get a share of $1 million. So I would encourage all of you to engage in participatory budgeting, because that can be one tool that we can use to bring more resources to make full good. With that said, thank you everyone.
Thank you very much. My name is Derek Christopher Suarez, and I'm the lead singer for a group called Los Ciegos del Barrio, and it's actually an all-blind Latin group here from New York City. And I'm also a small piece of the puzzle for Shock Entertainment. And it's an honor being here with all of you guys, and we hope that you will all continue to support the Mary Mitchell Center, along with Shock Entertainment Inc. with Felipe Vigneau, and it's nice to be here with a great group of musicians that we literally just threw together last minute. So hope you're having a good time, and keep on enjoying the afternoon. We're gonna come up with a couple more songs for you, so enjoy.
Mitchell is our home.